The problem with data is sometimes there's too much of it. Looking over a table of collected data, even a well-organized one, it can be really hard to tell what's going on. So what we need to do if we want to communicate the results or underlying themes of this data is to distill it down into a simple and digestible form. However, the ways we can do this will depend on the type of data and variables we have. If we have observations collected for a categorical variable with a limited number of categories, we would usually bring these together into a frequency table. A frequency table lists each of the options along with how many times they were observed in our dataset. To make it even more manageable, sometimes we'll calculate the percentages, and in this case, we refer to it as a relative frequency table. From these values, we can create visual representations of the data, such as pie charts, if we're particularly interested in the relative proportions, or column graphs. A column graph, or it can also be referred to as a bar graph, has the categorical variable along one axis, and then frequency or percentage frequency indicated on the other axis. Because it's categorical data, it wouldn't usually matter which order the possible options are presented in, but by convention, we should have gaps. When it comes to numerical data, especially if it's continuous data, there could be too many unique observations to organize it into a frequency table. So often we'll use a grouped frequency table instead. As the name suggests, in this case, we'll split the range of our data into intervals. These should be equal in size and shouldn't overlap. Depending on how many decimal places our data is given to, we'd be better to use, say, 1 to 10, 11 to 20, 21 to 30, and so on. We're allowed to choose these intervals, but as well as them being equal in size, we'd usually want to try to choose them so that there aren't so many that we have a whole lot of zero counts, but not so few that we can't properly see the spread and distribution of our data. From a grouped frequency table, we can create what's called a histogram. This is essentially the same as a column or bar graph, except that instead of the categorical variable across one of the axes, we have our continuous variable. The other axis will still give the count or relative frequency. Another key difference, and this is by convention, is to have no gaps between the bars. This is just as a way of signposting that our data is on a continuous scale and not separate categories. The other way we can represent numerical data graphically is with a box plot. In this case, we order the data and cut it into quartiles. The median cuts the data in two, and then the first and third quartiles cut those two sections in half again. Along with the minimum and the maximum, this gives us our five-number summary, which we place as markers along the scale over which the data was collected. The box indicates the middle 50% of the data, while the two remaining sections indicate where the top and bottom 25% of the data fall. They're quite a nice way of showing the spread and center of the data in a digestible way that also makes comparison easier, which we'll come to later. The term bivariate data is used when we have two variables relating to each of the observations. We can also have multivariate data, which is where we have even more variables, and remember that each variable might correspond with one column of our raw data table. Summarizing bivariate data allows us to compare different groups or look for relationships. If we have two categorical variables, we can organize the data into a two-way frequency table. When we convert this to a relative frequency table, we need to think carefully about how we calculate the percentages. In this case, are we interested in what percentage of the survivors were male? This is going to be largely affected by how many males were aboard the ship in the first place. Or are we interested in comparing males and females in terms of how likely they were to survive? In which case, we should ask, what percentage of male adults survived, and what percentage of female adults survived? When it comes to visualizing this data, we need to consider the message we want to communicate. In some cases, it might be okay to compare groups using multiple pie charts, but what's likely to be more useful is the use of cluster column graphs, where one of the axes still represents one of the variables, and the observations for the second variable are indicated by different colors. This allows us to compare counts or percentages across the different categories. If we're more interested in the relative proportions, then sometimes a stacked column graph might be better to convey our message. If we have one categorical variable and one numerical variable, the best way to compare the resulting groups would usually be with parallel box plots. Having multiple histograms can be okay too, but we want to make sure we keep our scales consistent for comparison. And if the categorical variable is binary, then a pyramid graph might be okay. This is just where we take two histograms and place them back to back. If we have two numerical variables, especially if both variables are continuous or have too many unique observations, then the standard tool is the scatter plot. This is a graph where each of the axes corresponds with a different numerical variable. These are particularly useful for identifying trends or patterns in the data. Of course, as more data becomes available, there are new and creative ways being invented all the time for how to best represent that data and uncover relationships. But it's important to keep in mind that the purpose here is communication. So the visual impression should align with actual quantities and relationships in the data. A graph that's too complicated for your audience to understand isn't helpful, and a graph that distorts or misleads is just generally bad practice. At best, it indicates that the creator has a poor understanding either of the data itself or guiding conventions such as the area principle, while at worst, it suggests that someone is willingly trying to use mathematics to serve bad purposes, which I'm sure we all agree is not very cool.